Recorded Books Incorporated presents selections from The Voyage of the Beagle by Charles Darwin, narrated by John Franklyn-Robbins, with additional material written by Edward Neeble and read by George Guidel. This work was first published in 1839 as Journal of Researches into the Geology and Natural History of the Various Countries Visited by the H.M.S. Beagle. This recording is copyrighted 1994 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. Charles Darwin's paternal grandfather, Erasmus, was a man of the Enlightenment. Eclectic, skeptical, and scientifically inquisitive, Dr. Erasmus Darwin was also a composer of erotic verse. He was a jovial, portly man with a keen wit. As a medical doctor, he prescribed sex for hypochondria, and himself fathered 12 children by 2 wives and 2 bastards by a governess. He was a free-thinking, wine-drinking, botanizing libertine. Erasmus Darwin had a lucrative practice in Litchfield. Nearby lived Josiah Wedgwood, Charles Darwin's maternal grandfather, whose factory, Etruria, produced the renowned earthenware. They were members of a group of newly wealthy industrialists based in Birmingham called the Lunar Society because their meetings were held on moonlit nights so that reveling lunatics might find their way home. Another friend was Joseph Priestley, chemist and radical Unitarian. Excepting Erasmus, who called Unitarianism a feather bed to catch a falling Christian, most of their circle were Unitarian, an egalitarian creed espousing happiness in this life as well as the next one. Erasmus hoped to have one of his sons carry on the medical tradition. The task fell to Robert Darwin, after the death of an older brother caused by infection incurred dissecting a child's brain at Edinburgh University. With this grim precedence, Robert, father of Charles, was put through medical school and given a practice in Shrewsbury, a day away from Birmingham and the lunatics. Erasmus was about to publish his poetic work, Botanic Garden, which included The Loves of Plants, anonymously published 2 years earlier, and was working on his most important scientific work, Zoonomia, when anti-republican riots broke out in 1791. The house and the chapel of Erasmus's friend, Joseph Priestley, Unitarian minister of Birmingham, were burned down. Priestley found refuge at Wedgwood's Etruria and soon emigrated to the United States, where he continued to preach the Unitarian word. The riots closed the Lunar Society. Erasmus, supporter of the American and French revolutions, was repeatedly censured and vilified. Dissenters, libertines, and liberals fell out of favor. Anglicanism and conformity were back, entombing the voluptuous 18th century beneath 100 years of neo-respectability. In 1796, Robert Darwin married Susanna Wedgwood, who had inherited £25,000 when her father Josiah died the year before. Robert Darwin became a popular doctor, and his Shrewsbury practice profitable. The Darwins set up a respectable upper-middle-class household. They had 3 daughters, and then, in 1804, 2 years after Erasmus died, they had their first son, naming him after the deceased grandfather. On February 12, 1809, Charles Robert Darwin was born, named after the other medical men of the family, the uncle who died studying medicine at Edinburgh, and his father. That Robert Darwin was a free thinker had to be concealed, for England was still at war with France, and the Darwin name was already associated with the atheism, republicanism, and supposed francophilia of Erasmus. It just wouldn't do for the Shrewsbury doctor to be known as a free thinker or a Unitarian. Desirous as the Darwins were of remaining socially respectable, if relatively new, members of the rural gentry, Charles was baptized at St. Chad's Anglican Church. All the same, Charles Darwin's mother discreetly took the children to a Unitarian chapel on Sundays. With his father aloof and irritable, his older brother Erasmus at school, and his four sisters domineering, the young Charles found solace in solitude, exploring the doctor's extraordinary library and sumptuous greenhouse, and fishing for hours alone in the Severn behind the Mount, as the family's fine house was called. Early on, he became a collector of rocks and shells. In his eighth year, his mother died after great suffering from a tumor, and his sisters took over his moral education. The formal education of the Darwin brothers was managed by their stern father, Dr. Darwin, who in 1818 sent Charles to join Erasmus at Shrewsbury School. Erasmus was bookish, but Charles was more an observer than a reader, a collector who enjoyed long solitary walks better than Latin and Greek. Eventually, Erasmus took an interest in chemistry, in which Charles enthusiastically joined him. Although the brothers' experiments were banned from the house after the release of noxious gases, the doctor outfitted their lab in the garden shed handsomely. Soon, Erasmus was sent away to Christ's College, Cambridge, and Charles was again left alone. But he so enjoyed his hours in the chemistry shed that he earned the nickname Gas Darwin. Hunting, along with collecting and chemistry, became a passion, and Charles spent considerable time at the Wedgwoods and shoots, which often turned into parties. His interest in his proper studies waned. At the age of 16, his father pulled him out of school and decided it was time he had a career. Charles was forced to spend the summer of 1825 practicing on the sick poor of Shrewsbury. At times he made rounds with Dr. Darwin, who saw potential in him. He was sent to Edinburgh University to study medicine, where his father, dead uncle, and grandfather studied before him. But despite all his hunting, collecting, and dissecting in Shrewsbury, Charles had no stomach for human blood. His visits to the operating theater made him sick. He was simply unsuited by nature for the medical profession. However, in Edinburgh, the Northern Athens, he did acquire a valuable skill. Taxidermy, taught him by a freed black slave, John Edmonton, who had a shop in the Edinburgh Museum. The lessons were inexpensive, and Charles was a good student and ready listener for his teacher's stories of the tropics of South America, stories which cemented the anti-slavery already instilled by his Whig family and stirred his interest in seeing the lush rainforests. Charles Darwin became a passionate naturalist, a fine hobby for the rural gentry, but no proper career. So his father sent him to Christ's College, Cambridge, intending that he should become a clergyman. Neither his Unitarian sisters nor his free-thinking father considered subscription to the 39 Articles of the Anglican Faith problematic. What mattered was social assimilation and respectability. Charles had no qualms about subscribing to the Anglican Articles required to take his degree in 1831, but he wasn't terribly enthusiastic about anything but science. At Edinburgh, he had already befriended the radical Robert Grant, marine life scientist who was an expert on the lowly sponge, and ornithologist Robert McGillivray. At Cambridge, he fell under the influence of the Reverend John Stevens Henslow, botany professor and natural history enthusiast, and the geologist Adam Sedgwick. It was the former who arranged for him the position as naturalist and gentleman dining companion for Captain Fitzroy aboard the H.M.S. Beagle on an expedition to South America. It was just what Darwin wanted. His sisters worried that the long voyage would rid Charles of his desire for a country parsonage, and his father, seeing it as a waste of time, objected outright. Until Charles's uncle, Josiah Wedgwood, said that he should go, that it would quell the wanderlust in the young man, and Dr. Darwin agreed. Little did the immediate family realize how right their initial instincts were. The voyage laid the foundation for his life's work, which would prove a tremendous threat to the established religious, social, and natural order. That order, for example, insisted that the earth was formed in a single cataclysmic upheaval, that its species, too, were all created in one fell swoop. If the geologists found the earth to be older than biblical time allowed, then biblical time was allegorical. But shells on mountainsides proved that the great flood survived by Noah and company was an historical event. Henslow, a staunch creationist, was nonetheless a gentleman scientist who was interested in other points of view. He sent Darwin Charles Lyell's Principles of Geology, warning him to disregard the blasphemous bit about the earth forming gradually. Surveying the barren rock of Patagonia, mining shell deposits in the Andes, and experiencing an earthquake in Chile led Darwin inexorably to Lyell's point of view. Charles Darwin also read Lamarck, the radical French naturalist and forerunner of Darwin in evolutionary theory. His own grandfather's Zoonomia, which anticipated Lamarck, and Malthus's An Essay on the Principle of Population. These, combined with his own observations and creative genius, produced an hypothesis earth-shattering to eminent Victorians. Species transmutate, or evolve. Man descended from the apes. The discovery was, he later wrote, like confessing a murder. At the time of the Beagle's departure from England, however, Darwin was still a curious young naturalist and geology enthusiast who agreed with his family that a country parsonage would be just the thing when he returned. The voyage of the Beagle exhibits, in a series of observations as fascinating as the varied landscapes, flora, fauna, and races therein, the evolution of Darwin's thought away from Whig country gentlemen toward ultimate debunker of man's high estate. He didn't open his secret notebook entitled Transmutation of the Species until 1837, a year after his voyage, but it commences with facts obtained on the voyage, which he refers to as the origin of all my views. And now, selections from The Voyage of the Beagle.
After having been twice driven back by heavy southwestern gales, Her Majesty's ship Beagle, a 10-gun brig, under the command of Captain Fitzroy, R.N., sailed from Devonport on the 27th of December, 1831. The object of the expedition was to complete the survey of Patagonia and Tierra del Fuego, commenced under Captain King in 1826 to 1830, to survey the shores of Chile, Peru, and of some islands in the Pacific, and to carry a chain of chronometrical measurements round the world. On the 6th of January, we reached Tenerife, but were prevented landing by fears of our bringing the cholera. The next morning we saw the sun rise behind the rugged outline of the Grand Canary Island and suddenly illumine the peak of Tenerife, whilst the lower parts were veiled in fleecy clouds. This was the first of many delightful days never to be forgotten. On the 16th of January, 1832, we anchored at Porto Praya, in the chief island of the Cape de Verde archipelago. Bahia, or San Salvador, Brazil, February the 29th. The day has passed delightfully. Delight itself, however, is a weak term to express the feelings of a naturalist who, for the first time, has wandered by himself in a Brazilian forest. The elegance of the grasses, the novelty of the parasitical plants, the beauty of the flowers, the glossy green of the foliage, but, above all, the general luxuriance of the vegetation filled me with admiration. A most paradoxical mixture of sound and silence pervades the shady parts of the wood. The noise from the insects is so loud that it may be heard even in a vessel anchored several hundred yards from the shore. Yet within the recesses of the forest, a universal silence appears to reign. To a person fond of natural history, such a day as this brings with it a deeper pleasure than he can ever hope to experience again. After wandering about for some hours, I returned to the landing place. But before reaching it, I was overtaken by a tropical storm. I tried to find shelter under a tree, which was so thick that it would never have been penetrated by common English rain, but here, in a couple of minutes, a little torrent flowed down the trunk. It is to this violence of the rain that we must attribute the verdure at the bottom of the thickest woods. If the showers were like those of a colder clime, the greater part would be absorbed or evaporated before it reached the ground. Along the whole coast of Brazil, for a length of at least 2,000 miles, and certainly for a considerable space inland, wherever solid rock occurs, it belongs to a granitic formation. The circumstance of this enormous area being constituted of materials which most geologists believe to have been crystallized when heated under pressure gives rise to many curious reflections. Was this effect produced beneath the depths of a profound ocean? Or did a covering of strata formerly extend over it, which has since been removed? Can we believe that any power, acting for a time short of infinity, could have denuded the granite over so many thousand square leagues? Rio de Janeiro, April 4th to July the 5th, 1832. A few days after our arrival, I became acquainted with an Englishman who was going to visit his estate, situated, rather more than 100 miles from the capital, to the northward of Cape Frio. I gladly accepted his kind offer of allowing me to accompany him. April the 8th. Our party amounted to 7. The first stage was very interesting. The day was powerfully hot, and as we passed through the woods, everything was motionless, excepting the large and brilliant butterflies which lazily fluttered about. The view seen when crossing the hills behind Praia Grande was most beautiful. The colours were intense, and the prevailing tint a dark blue. The sky and the calm waters of the bay vied with each other in splendour. After passing through some cultivated country, we entered a forest, which in the grandeur of all its parts could not be exceeded. We arrived by midday at Ithacaya. This small village is situated on a plain, and round the central house are the huts of the Negroes. These, from their regular form and position, reminded me of the drawings of the Hottentot habitations in southern Africa. As the moon rose early, we determined to start the same evening for our sleeping place at the Lagoa Marica. As it was growing dark, we passed under one of the massive, bare, and steep hills of granite which are so common in this country. This spot is notorious from having been for a long time the residence of some runaway slaves who, by cultivating a little ground near the top, contrived to eke out a subsistence. At length they were discovered, and a party of soldiers being sent, the whole were seized, with the exception of one old woman, who, sooner than again be led into slavery, dashed herself to pieces from the summit of the mountain. In a Roman matron this would have been called the noble love of freedom. In a poor negress it is mere brutal obstinacy. We continued riding for some hours. For the few last miles, the road was intricate, and it passed through a desert waste of marshes and lagoons. The scene, by the dimmed light of the moon, was most desolate. A few fireflies flitted by us, and the solitary snipe, as it rose, uttered its plaintive cry. The distant and sullen roar of the sea scarcely broke the stillness of the night. April the 10th. We again entered the forest. The trees were very lofty and remarkable, compared with those of Europe, from the whiteness of their trunks. I see by my notebook wonderful and beautiful flowering parasites. Invariably struck me as the most novel object in these grand scenes. Travelling onwards, we passed through tracts of pasturage, much injured by the enormous conical ants' nests, which were nearly 12 feet high. They gave to the plain exactly the appearance of the mud volcanoes at Horuyo, as figured by Humboldt. We arrived at Enhenhodo after it was dark, having been 10 hours on horseback. I never ceased, during the whole journey, to be surprised at the amount of labour which the horses were capable of enduring. They appeared also to recover from any injury much sooner than those of our English breed. The vampire bat is often the cause of much trouble by biting the horses on their withers. The injury is generally not so much owing to the loss of blood as to the inflammation which the pressure of the saddle afterwards produces. The whole circumstance has lately been doubted in England. I was therefore fortunate in being present when one was actually caught on a horse's back. We were bivouacking late one evening near Coquimbo in Chile when my servant, noticing that one of the horses was very restive, went to see what was the matter, and fancying he could distinguish something, suddenly put his hand on the beast's withers and secured the vampire. In the morning, the spot where the bite had been inflicted was easily distinguished from being slightly swollen and bloody. The third day afterwards, we rode the horse without any ill effects. April the 14th. We rode to another estate, which was the last patch of cultivated ground in that direction. The estate was 2.5 miles long, and the owner had forgotten how many broad. Only a very small piece had been cleared, yet almost every acre was capable of yielding all the various rich productions of a tropical land. Considering the enormous area of Brazil, the proportion of cultivated ground can scarcely be considered as anything compared to that which is left in the state of nature. At some future age, how vast a population it will support. During the second day's journey, we found the road so shut up that it was necessary that a man should go ahead with a sword to cut away the creepers. The forest abounded with beautiful objects, among which the tree ferns, though not large, were, from their bright green foliage and the elegant curvature of their fronds, most worthy of admiration. In the evening it rained very heavily, and although the thermometer stood at 65 degrees, I felt very cold. As soon as the rain ceased, it was curious to observe the extraordinary evaporation which commenced over the whole extent of the forest. At the height of 100 feet, the hills were buried in a dense white vapour, which rose like columns of smoke from the most thickly wooded parts, and especially from the valleys. I observed this phenomenon on several occasions. I suppose it is owing to the large surface of foliage previously heated by the sun's rays. While staying at this estate, I was very nearly being an eyewitness to one of those atrocious acts which can only take place in a slave country. Owing to a quarrel and a lawsuit, the owner was on the point of taking all the women and children from the male slaves and selling them separately at the public auction at Rio. Interest, and not any feeling of compassion, prevented this act. Indeed, I do not believe the inhumanity of separating 30 families who had lived together for many years even occurred to the owner. Yet I will pledge myself that in humanity and good feeling he was superior to the common run of men. It may be said there exists no limit to the blindness of interest and selfish habit. I may mention one very trifling anecdote which at the time struck me more forcibly than any story of cruelty. I was crossing a ferry with a negro, who was uncommonly stupid. In endeavouring to make him understand, I talked loud and made signs, in doing which I passed my hand near his face. He, I suppose, thought I was in a passion and was going to strike him, for instantly, with a frightened look and half-shut eyes, he dropped his hands. I shall never forget my feelings of surprise, disgust, and shame at seeing a great, powerful man afraid even to ward off a blow directed, as he thought, at his face. This man had been trained to a degradation lower than the slavery of the most helpless animal. One day, at Bahia, my attention was drawn by observing many spiders, cockroaches, and other insects, and some lizards, rushing in the greatest agitation across a bare piece of ground. A little way behind, every stalk and leaf was blackened by a small ant. The swarm, having crossed the bare space, divided itself and descended an old wall. By this means, many insects were fairly enclosed, and the efforts which the poor little creatures made to extricate themselves from such a death were wonderful. When the ants came to the road, they changed their course, and in narrow files reascended the wall. Having placed a small stone so as to intercept one of the lines, the whole body attacked it, and then immediately retired. Shortly afterwards, another body came to the charge, and again, having failed to make any impression, this line of march was entirely given up. By going an inch round, the file might have avoided the stone, and this doubtless would have happened if it had been originally there. But having been attacked, the lion-hearted little warriors scorned the idea of yielding. Certain wasp-like insects, which construct in the corners of the verandas clay cells for their larvae, are very numerous in the neighbourhood of Rio. These cells they stuff full of half-dead spiders and caterpillars, which they seem wonderfully to know how to sting to that degree as to leave them paralysed but alive until their eggs are hatched. And the larvae feed on the horrid mass of powerless half-killed victims, a sight which has been described by an enthusiastic naturalist as curious and pleasing. I was much interested one day by watching a deadly contest between a pepsis and a large spider of the genus Lycosa. The wasp made a sudden dash at its prey and then flew away. The spider was evidently wounded, for trying to escape, it rolled down a little slope, but had still strength sufficient to crawl into a thick tuft of grass. The wasp soon returned, and seemed surprised at not immediately finding its victim. It then commenced as regular a hunt as ever hound did after fox, making short semicircular casts, and all the time rapidly vibrating its wings and antennae. The spider, though well concealed, was soon discovered, and the wasp evidently...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.